And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Bethany, Oklahoma, and SNU Football Stadium. It's the Crimson and White Spring Game for Southern Nazarene football tonight. Delighted to have you with us. Luke McConnell here on the call with former SNU offensive lineman Sam Perkins. Sam, thanks for joining me this evening. It should be a gorgeous night here. Should be a fun night to get the pads cracking and throwing the pigskin around a little bit.
Yeah, it's my honor to be here. I can't wait to see what these guys have to bring to the table this year.
So we've got Crimson and White, the full squad out there tonight, full pads. Let you know on the format here in Coach Dustin Hayda's second spring. And it's so hard to quantify Coach Hayda's tenure thus far. I mean, he came in, got hired in December, then COVID hit in the middle of the first spring practice, and the season gets canceled. You have a spring season last year going into the 2021 season. His opening year, SNU goes 1-10. It's just so hard to quantify that, but he mentioned to us multiple times last year just how important that time together was to really build that culture without having to worry about wins, losses, game reps, things like that. And I think we kind of saw that just in the way SNU played last year.
Yeah, I would agree. Anytime you can get together as a team and not have all that pressure on you, it really just helps everybody relax and just focus on getting better throughout the season. And, yeah.
So tonight we've got 4 10-minute quarters for you, and we've got full rosters. We've got accurate rosters, so it won't be a guessing game on who's wearing what. Some players are in a little bit of different numbers than past seasons, so bear with us as we get used to those for tonight. So we got 4 10-minute quarters, a very short intermission at halftime, but we also, throughout the evening, will have various coaches coming up and joining us to just talk football with us, Sam. So it should be a lot of fun. We'll have Associate Head Coach Kenneth West up here first, and then Indy Sindel, the newly minted defensive coordinator for the Crimson Storm. He'll be with us in the second quarter. Coach Hayda will join us around halftime and into the third quarter, and then offensive line coach Nathan Brown, who also coordinates the special teams, will be with us for the final stanza. So we'll do our best up here. It's a gorgeous evening here in Bethany. Great crowd on hand, too. Get a look. And Sam, spring practice always, to the outsiders, probably just like why get ramped up for it? But these reps really do matter.
Yeah. Spring game for me, I learned a lot. So if you're a freshman and you're coming into spring game, this is your real first taste, if you didn't play during the regular season, of what live action football is all about in college football. And it can be a real wake-up call to some of these freshmen.
A lot of redshirt freshmen dotting this roster, and a lot of these guys are redshirt freshmen by classification, but really they've been on campus even longer than that because of the COVID year that was canceled. So there's a lot of experienced freshmen out here. No true freshmen in this game, according to our rosters. So nobody has arrived on campus yet, early enrollees and things like that. So none of that. But lots of redshirt freshmen here in this game. And you've got a really wide range of experience on this roster. You got several graduate seniors who have been around the program for a long time. And then you've got, you know, these redshirt freshmen who maybe long in practice and long in being around, but just haven't gotten those game reps just yet.
Yeah, I talked to several of the coaches before about 5:30 this evening, and I asked the same question. I said, how has COVID really affected the games and practices? And he said, you know what, with everything that happened, gaining the extra year of eligibility for some of these players has been the best thing that has happened. You got sophomores playing like juniors because really they should be juniors, but because they got that off year, they are more experienced.
So tonight we've got Crimson versus White, obviously, and it is even teams, Sam. It's not a maybe kind of gave the first team offense white, and then we'll have them switch at halftime and stuff. No, looking at the rosters, they're pretty evenly divided. You've got starters on both sides. You've got quarterback Gage Porter on one side. You've got quarterback Jarvis Davis on the other. So it should be a pretty even matchup back and forth as far as personnel goes. And obviously we'll see how this goes. You saw some of the guys, you know, chirping at each other a little bit as they went off to their respective sidelines after getting loose and everything out there on the field. So should be some good football here tonight and a good early look at what SNU has coming into 2022.
Oh, yeah, spring game can definitely get a little chippy, as you said. We see them yapping at each other a little bit. I mean, if you really stop and think about it, they're actually competing for each other's jobs here early on. They're trying to get the best look.
So Ray Blatnick will kick this one away. You've got Trent Smith and Josh Johnson back deep for this. Oh, it'll be Trent Smith
fumble.
Who muffs it at the goal line. He picks it up at the 10, cutting up field at the 15, and he's met right there at about the 17-18-yard line. Number 44 in white, Tavita Crisp, on the tackle. And we saw Tavita make quite a few plays on special teams a season ago and making one right there. And that is where the white team will start first and 10 at their own 18-yard line.
Man, it looks like the kickoff team had all their holes covered up pretty good.
So Gage Porter, wearing number 22 tonight, will lead the white offense out onto the field this evening. Porter, the graduate senior from Elk City. And offensive lineman Peyton Spencer at center. Caleb Bates at right guard. And David Morales at right tackle. We'll get the other two in a minute. Carlos Thomas on the carry right up the middle. And he's met at about the 22-yard line. Eli Calhoun down on the tackle along with Nick Blanchard.
Yeah, that was a really good play to start off the scrimmage. Right up the middle, nothing tricky.
That left side of the line, Zach Cizik at left guard. And it looks like David Armijo out at left tackle. Both of those guys, sophomores. Brandon Perez coming in motion there to the near side. And we've got a flag on the field. A false start on the white team. We'll back it up 5 yards, make it second down and 11.
Yeah, I got a feeling we'll be seeing a few penalties during this game.
So 3 wide to the left, 1 to the right. For Porter, looking to the left. Short route is pulled in by Jarrell Farr, and he gets the penalty yardage back and then some, so it'll be 3rd down and 4 at the 24-yard line. So now 3 wide right, as now 2 to each side. Perez goes up to the top of the formation. And now we've got another false start. Well, that'll back it up 5 yards and make it now 3rd down and 9. And we're joined in the booth by Coach Kenneth West. Coach West, thanks for joining us up here and giving us a little bit of insight into this SNU program.
Oh yeah, it's the best seat in the house right here, so I can see a lot better up here than I can on that sideline, that's for sure.
Well, Coach West, this is your second time at SNU. Just kind of take us through what drew you back to the Crimson Storm program.
You know, a lot of it was the culture, and you know, I can't help. You know, I had the feeling I had some unfinished business. You know, didn't leave with a great taste in my mouth as far as our winning record, you know, or the record is concerned. And man, but it was no better place. I just love the place, and so it brought me back. It drew me back. Coach Hayda reached out to me, and it was kind of a no-brainer for me.
Gage Porter on the carry there on third down, met by David Omasego on the outside. Will bring Ryan Reed on to punt, and Joah Flores back deep to return this kick. And Coach West, you handle the wide receivers on this SNU offense, and you ask your wide receivers to do a lot in the offense you run.
Absolutely.
What is it like recruiting that position when you ask your players to do so much?
You know, it always helps when they have a little bit of blocking on their film, you know, instead of just the touchdown catches. Our receivers are going to be asked to do a myriad of things. You know, we're going to put them in the backfield. We're going to put them at receiver. We're going to put them in one-on-one situations with dudes they got to block for us to be successful in. We grew a lot in that area, so I'm extremely excited for the fall.
Is that an area that is tough to evaluate, just given the prevalence of spread offenses and wide receivers? You know, you go four or five wide a lot now in high school football. Is it tough to evaluate the blocking of wide receivers out there on the recruiting trail?
It is. So there's some good and bad. So you don't get to see it as much in. The good thing is when they come in, a lot of times they're a blank slate. And so I get to teach them, you know, fundamentally sound ways to block. And you know, the guys that buy into it, man, they become really good blockers for us. Sometimes it takes a year or two, but fundamentally, if we can get them sound, they make tremendous strides in blocking on the perimeter.
Jarvis Davis on that first down carry gains one down to the 36-yard line. And Josh Lopez, the sophomore who led the team with 84 tackles a season ago, on the stop. Coach West, what's the spring been like for you guys and guys that have really stood out to you?
You know what? It's been extremely exciting. Just because, you know, we didn't have to, you know, deal with things like COVID and things like that kind of throw, a little wrench in how we go about things. And so we've been able to have a good, healthy spring. Guys like the guy just on the carrier, Angel Ramirez, is going to be big for us this year. Up front, you know, Grayson Winters anchoring down that offensive line along with Brayden Jones is just going to be tremendous for us. And we got depth like we've never had before. And so that'll go a long way for us this fall.
Coach, take us through this third down play. What do you see here?
Here we go. We got a little bit of a quarterback power right there to try to see if we can get a pick up a couple. We're going to be close. If I know anything about Coach Hayden, he's going to go for this. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't know about a field goal team. Maybe extra time. Oh, field goal. Right when I thought I knew the man,
he goes. You got to take advantage of that strong south breeze we got tonight.
Oh, yeah. Hey, and you know what? Our kicker, you know, Reed's a dude. So I like to refer to him as Legatron because he's a big dude with a big leg. That's for sure.
What is he, 6'6"?
He's 6'6". His weight varies, you know, but it's muscle now, you know. He's been working on that a little bit, you know. But he's a dude. When we roll him out in the pregame, they're like, man, who's that dude? And then they see the boot, get in there, ball.
Wide right.
Just ride right from 45. And saw Jarvis Davis out there as the holder as well. So we'll swap sides here with the white offense going back out on the field. And Coach, been told that you are a bit of the grill master on staff.
Oh, man.
How did you come into that particular role with this bunch?
You know, it started as me like, you know what, I'm going to throw something on the grills for these guys on this Friday. Turned into every Friday. And so we pitch in and get it hooked up, but it's a feast on Fridays around here. I guess we're off tomorrow, but man, anytime you want to roll up, you come on by. About 11:30 every Friday, it's going to be something growing out there.
Might have to change our weekly meetings with Coach Hayda to 11:20 on Fridays. move those up a little bit. How big is that to be able to have that continuity, that camaraderie on the staff?
You know, me and Price, Coach Price, we actually talked about that a couple of days ago. The fact that we get to break bread and with one another and go out and have just a good, you know, a good culture around our staff and guys buying into what we want and being able to have, you know, tough conversations about what we need to have done. I mean, it's just – It's nothing like being there's Joa from New Mexico. I'll see if he can get on out of there.
Flores breaks into the open field. Finally, Russell Dale and by Hiram Flores all the way out near midfield. But a big pickup there for Flores, a redshirt freshman out of Albuquerque. And the white team's going to go fast here. Coach, you guys used tempo with pretty judiciously, but in key moments like that.
Yep. We can operate fast when we want to, and a lot of times when we get that momentum going, we try to hang on to it. But yeah, man, just this staff and the staff that we're continuing to put together, we got another spot or two of the field. It's just the continuity's there, and that's extremely important. And our players need to see that in us, and so goes pretty far for us.
Sam, anything for Coach?
Oh, Sammy P, man, this is my guy right here. As soon as he walked through the door, I lit up. He was like, "I'm play-by-playing it a little bit." I'm like, "Oh, that's pretty sweet."
Yeah. Well, you mentioned a little bit about your depth. Where are you most at depth at here with this team?
You know, we're going to be pretty solid at linebacker. We're creating some more depth on the D line. We want to see that grow a little bit. Our receiving core, we got a ton of varsity dudes that can play, and it actually increased the competition with those guys because we were so deep. You know, at tight end, man, we got a ton of depth at tight end like we've never had before, and so get ready for some three tight end jumbo package stuff come the fall.
Yeah, and we also talked about the COVID year and how that allowed some of these players to stay an extra year. How has that affected the team?
You know, I think it helped us just with leadership. You know, we were able to have guys stick around that just wanted to see the program change. And they, you know, when you dedicate another year to trying to make sure that culture is changing and you're going in the right direction, it's just good. It's good for everybody. It's good for the young guys. It's good for those older guys who get to, you know, finish out, you know, playing at their best and playing as hard as they can. So it's just it was an opportunity for guys to grow, and I think we did that.
Excellent.
Well, Coach, thank you so much for your time. We'll let you get back down to the sidelines, but looking forward to the 22 season and seeing continued growth and success for this Crimson Storm program.
Absolutely. Hey, I'll come up here anytime y'all want. You know, it can be, you know, game. I'm up here.
Hey,
this is sweet. Watch when I get down here. We're gonna score though. Watch this.
you got the special plays on your sheet.
Yeah, I've been holding back the tricky stuff.
Anyway. All right, Coach. Thank you so much for your time.
All righty, y'all. Thank y'all for having me. God bless.
Thank you.
Coach Kenneth West joining us up here in the booth. Again, we'll have defensive coordinator Indy Sindel coming up in the second quarter. And out there on that last series, you saw backup quarterback Jordan Olderup out there from Pflugerville, Texas, redshirt freshman. So we're going to see a lot of guys tonight as Ray Blatnick sends that boot away. And Flores runs up and makes the catch just outside the 20-yard line, about the 22-yard line. So far, defense taking advantage, as you would expect In the inert squad scrimmage, Sam, the defense just has just a monumental advantage.
Oh, yeah,
just
yeah.
knowing the calls and everything.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you're hearing the play call all throughout the weeks leading up to this, and then you're seeing the same guys and run the same thing. So they have a huge advantage.
So coming out on the red squad here is Bryson Evans at quarterback. He's a redshirt freshman out of Wichita, Kansas. Carlos Cepeda is the back, and Cepeda's got the ball, and he fumbled it as he was getting to the line of scrimmage. And that is recovered by the white squad at the 21-yard line. And it looked like number 32, Ben Rutherford, getting some love over there on the far side, and redshirt freshman out of Carrollton, Texas.
Yeah, it looks like the quarterback and the running back just did not have a good transfer there.
And again, that's what these reps are for. You know, you get into kind of a more live action situation. Good to have as many guys as possible getting those reps out there. So Gage Porter comes back out at quarterback for this series. Andrew Tisdale and Jarrell Farr to the left. Brandon Perez to the right. Edion Batt is the tight end on the right side. And Carlos Thomas, the running back. Porter's back to pass. Fakes the swing. He's in trouble in the backfield. Escapes the tackle of Aaron Randall. Still scrambling around. Looking for help. Still scrambling. And finally ushered out of bounds after officially a loss of one. No, I think they're going to put it right at the line of scrimmage at the 21. Yeah, so they'll put it back at the line of scrimmage. And, Sam, that was Gage Porter in a nutshell right there.
Yes, he can make nothing out of some – or you can make something out of nothing there. He was looking to get about a 10, 15-yard loss and used his wheels to run away from it.
Porter missing most of last season with that shoulder injury. Jarvis Davis taking over the reins of the offense and did a great job throughout the year. And, you know, big growth for Jarvis throughout the year. Thomas goes out to the right. Porter bobbles the snap, following his blockers around the right side. Met by fellow graduate senior Dylan Bauer down at the 17-yard line. And the two guys who have been around a while here, Sam.
Yeah, they were here when I was here. And they have definitely improved a lot. Yep, and I also want to point out that the center, I think the reason why the quarterback's fumbling this is because the center is snapping him pretty low, which is expected to be seen in a spring game.
It's probably because center for the white team, Peyton Spencer, cut that beautiful mullet of his.
Oh, yes. I think that's the reason why. Samson lost his strength.
Exactly. So two wide right, one to the left. Here comes Perez in motion to the near side, making it three wide to the right. Porter rolls that way, looks for the throwback screen to Edion Batta, but it was a little bit too far inside.
And that was a good read by Elijah Estes. He stayed right along the line of scrimmage, almost like he knew that play was coming.
This screens like that, there's just so much that goes into those, and that one, you wonder, you know, is Batta too far toward the sideline? Is Porter throw it too far to the middle? You know, there's all sorts of little nuances within this offense where just a smidge of missed time or missed position, and things can go south in a hurry.
In a jiffy. That really has to be a perfect throw.
Here's Farr in motion. Porter sticks it in his belly on fourth down. Farr trying to get to the corner. He got right at the marker. They're going to give him the first down. Aaron Randall over there tried to chop him down right before the sticks, but unable to do so. And Farr comes up a little gimpy, favoring that left ankle. Which, you know, things like that are going to happen. You know, injuries. You know, football is a rough sport, so you want to avoid it when it's your own team on your own team, but things like that can definitely happen at times. So first and goal at the 10. Porter fakes the give to Thomas, now trying to bounce it outside. He does get around the corner before being ushered out of bounds by Hiram Flores at about the 7-yard line. So it'll be second and goal from there.
Yeah, Gage Porter was looking like Derrick Henry out there with that stiff arm.
And Sam, when you look at this SNU offense, what's the goal for the SNU offense?
Well, I can speak from an offensive line standpoint, and that is you want to create huge holes so that you don't have to make that running back second guess anything. They know where they want to go, and you make it easy for them to get there. Without the O-line, you really can't do anything, whether that be run or pass. So, yeah.
Second down, Porter running right. Opts not to pitch it, and he holds on to it, and he's going to be taken down by Randall and redshirt freshman Emmanuel Obina, the linebacker from Georgetown, Texas, just north of Austin.
And they lost about a yard on that play, but I think it was a good option not to pass it out there because they were all over that play and they would have had a bigger loss.
So third down here for the Crimson Storm white team from the 8-yard line, third and goal. Too wide to either side. Porter looking for Flores on the quick slant. It's a little bit behind him and also knocked down by Obina again. And Aaron Randall with nice coverage there as well. So 27 seconds to go in the first quarter. We'll do 4 10-minute quarters with about a 5-minute halftime break in between. Head coach Kenneth West up with us here in this first quarter. We'll have newly minted defensive coordinator Indy Sindel up with us in the second quarter. So fourth and goal, white team going for it. Porter flushed, rolls to his left, trying to get outside, fires to the short corner, and he's got Flores for the touchdown.
Wow, I guess Coach West was right. He said as soon as he goes down there, they were going to score a touchdown.
He was right indeed, and again, another going for it on fourth down, which, you know, in an inter-squad game, why not? No reason not to, but that's something we saw a lot of last year. SNU led the conference by far going for it on fourth downs in the Great American Conference a season ago. That is, you know, you talk about, you know, wanting to stay aggressive, be aggressive, and, you know, I think it's really important for, you know, for the players to see that aggression coming from the coaching staff as well. It's one thing to preach that and ask for that from your players, but then you get to see that from your coaches saying, hey, I trust you to go get this first down.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. To be able to go out there and go for it on a fourth down, you have to have 100% trust in your guys' abilities to make the play.
Blatnick sends the extra point up and through. So 22 and a half seconds to go in the period, and the white leads the Crimson squad 7-0. And again, we've got a full squad scrimmage here. Nothing that's going to be shifted around or anything. Pretty evenly dispersed roster on both sides. So it'll be, say, Orion Reed will be kicking off here for special teams. Is a mixed bag both sides. Just to make it a little bit easier, probably a little bit easier than trying to come up with a full special teams plan for each squad. Just keep that all the same. And we are joined now by Indy Sindel, who is coaches the defensive backs for the Crimson Storm, also SNU's new defensive coordinator. And Indy, congrats again.
Hey, thanks. I appreciate
it. On the job title change.
Yeah, it's been a blast. We've got a great group of kids on defense, and they're working really hard right now, so it's been outstanding.
Kickoff comes down to Flores, and he's going to be chopped down at the 16-yard line. That is Ethan Miner, redshirt freshman from Huntsville, Texas, on the tackle. So it'll be the Crimson team with the ball, 17 seconds to go here in the first quarter. And Indy, you've been with the program a while.
Yep.
You know, what's it been like being one of the elder statesmen on the staff?
Well, number one, it's crazy to think about. I got here in 2017, and you know, time's just flown by. To be an older, I guess, kind of an older coach now is surreal to me. I mean, I was a graduate assistant. I was the lowest of the low when I came here. And so the main thing I would think is just continuity within the staff is very good right now. Coaches are communicating well. We're all on the same page, and we're hoping that just continues to trickle down with the players. Again, we've got a great group of guys, especially defensively. I feel really good about kind of the strides that we've made. And then some of those freshmen that we have coming in, we're super excited about helping us as well.
You're, as defensive coordinator, you'll be the third different person in the last three seasons to hold that role. But can we expect a lot of changes from year to year?
Good question, yeah. There are some things that are going to be a little bit different. We're still going to base out of a 3-4. So that's not really going to change. And then, you know, we can shift to a 4-man front. Again, we don't have the depth right now for it. We've got a few guys coming in that potentially could help us there. There's some coverage things that we've switched up that are completely new. And so spring has been huge for us in that. But as far as the bare bones, it's going to look very similar. Just some tweaks and changes, and then I'm sure we're going to continue to change in the off season as we kind of review personnel and different things like that. But the main thing that I'm looking forward to is seeing a defense that plays together, all on the same page, communicating well, playing fast. We've got to tackle well, and we've got to get turnovers. We've got to be better with turnovers, tackling, and then red zone defense is paramount in our conference. You know, the best teams take the ball away and they stop teams in the red zone, whether that's taking the ball away in the red zone or forcing field goals.
It was Jarvis Davis getting the first down, Milik Ritchie on the tackle. And you mentioned you don't have that depth yet to be necessarily consistent on a 4-man front. And I think a lot of people might think, well, new guy wants to implement his system or how he sees things. But it's a little bit more difficult than that because you've spent time as a staff recruiting to a certain way of doing things, and you can't just completely flip-flop it and expect you to have the horses to do that.
100%. And Coach Hayda is great in that he really preaches what makes us different is going to make us succeed. And so we don't run the same offense that, you know, the majority of our conference runs, and we don't run the same defense. And so we've got to put our guys in the best spot for them to be successful. And we feel like our base defense with a 3-man front, getting a lot of movement, 80 to 90% of the time, bringing a fourth guy with an outside linebacker. And then our overall slant game up front, what we have those guys do each and every play, that does set us apart. A lot of the teams in our conference are more 4-2-5. There's even some 4-3 teams, and so we are completely different. It's going to take, from week to week, new preparation for those offenses. And then again, like you said, the strength of our team right now, we've got a good group of linebackers, both insides and outsides, and defensive backs. And then we feel really good about our defensive line too. But again, the depth isn't there. So just continuing with that 3-4 continuity, I think is crucial moving forward. And the guys, like I said, they've been doing a great job with it.
Davis, third down pass just wide of Donald May there on third down. So it'll be fourth down and 3 from the 38-yard line. And as we've seen thus far, Coach Hayda can just keep rolling it out there. I think we know Ryan and Ray can both punt the football pretty well. Indy, when you look at the spring, who are some guys that have stood out? You've got Trent Smith back there, your veteran leader in the secondary. Josh Johnson really came on last year at corner. Who's really stood out to you here in the spring?
Well, I will say, Trent gets a lot of the publicity in our secondary, and rightfully so. He's been, a great player for us for 4 years now. Eli Calhoun really is a great leader for us. He's a great voice. He knows exactly what the coaches are looking for. He's an extremely intelligent football player. His play recognition is by far the best on our defense. And then kind of a younger guy, Jamari Johnson's really impressed me. So I've been working with the outside linebackers mostly this spring, and he's just been fantastic. You know, continual growth with him and just coming in with a positive mindset every single day just works really hard. So I'm super excited for his future.
Sam, you got anything?
Well, you kind of took my last question there. I was going to ask, you know, who was going to be coming up on the up and up for
yeah,
you.
Yeah.
And, well, you answered that one.
Yeah. I think we've got a good group of younger guys that are really coachable right now. So while Jamari is a guy that I've really noticed in spring, I think our young outside linebackers kind of as a whole have just been working really hard. You know, David Omasego is a guy played defensive end last year. He's still playing both, but he's played more outside linebacker this spring. We've kind of got two positions there, and he's worked out well at our rush position. So getting after the quarterback, a little more blitzing from him, which is something that he's kind of got a knack for right now. So all of those guys are improving daily. And then even Dylan Bauer, who played inside last year, we've moved him to outside. He's, you know, he can still play both, but he brings a lot of leadership to that room, and he's played in a lot of games for us. So overall, I think that group can continue to improve and be a strength for us.
Right on cue there, Andy. You saw Omasego and Nick Blanchard, two young guys who really popped last year in moments, come up with the tackle for loss on Oldrup. Am I saying that right?
Oldorp.
Yeah. There you go. This is a good trial for all of us here, learning all the new pronunciations on the fly as well. I think one thing that stands out to me, what you guys have done as a staff over these last two cycles, is you guys ask different things from your personnel as far as what you want them to look like physically than I think a traditional football guy would think. But it seems that there's a lot more traditional looking and
absolutely.
You listing height, weight type players out there now than there were before this staff really took over.
Yeah. So part of that too is, you know, we're just like anybody else, we're trying to get the biggest, the strongest, the fastest football players that we can. But also they have to fit a certain mold. And so being able to move so much up front on the defensive line, you know, usually if you find a guy that moves as well as you want inside, you know, at, you know, 280 plus, those are typically Division I football players. And so we've had to develop guys kind of at that position, and then we've had a little bit of attrition, you know, a few guys leave the program. But a guy like Marcus Sowell, for example, at defensive end, he's been dynamite. He's great to coach. He's taken the weight room very seriously. Our nutrition program has really helped him. He's added probably 25 pounds since he's been here. And so he had the frame, obviously, to do that. You know, and maybe in years past we didn't have that. I think one thing that's really helped is, you know, a lot of people are talking about the transfer portal. And to be honest, I think it's helped us a lot because we're able to get more kids on campus than ever before. Because so many programs, whether it's FCS or even Division II sometimes, a lot of programs are really turning to the portal. Hey, I want guys that are already college strong or already have college experience. And so for us, it's just allowed us to, you know, get more kids on campus. And then just continuing to, you know, the mindset Coach Hayter really preaches is leave no stone unturned in recruiting, and just work at it day in and day out. And so we've done a really good job of that, I feel like. So hopefully we reap the benefits with our young guys. I think it's a really good group.
Nice creation there by Gage Porter, avoiding the sack fines. Running back CJ Cardenas out in the flat, and he takes it down inside the 10 for a first and goal situation at the 5. And Indy, you've been kind of the operations guy for the football program the last few years. Is that something that you will continue with your defensive coordinator responsibilities?
So right now, we're in the process of hiring two GAs. Gosh, that's not really good to look at right there. But anyway, we're in the process of hiring two GAs, and those guys are, you know, obviously crucial with that day-to-day stuff. And so it's kind of been all hands on deck for spring, but it's been great. Our coaches work together. We collaborate. We're all on the same page. So everybody really, really pulls their weight. For this season, yes, I will still be doing most of the travel stuff and everything with that and football ops stuff. But that's something that I enjoy, you know, trying to help Coach Hayda's vision and give us the best travel experience as best as we can. You know, I love doing that for the kids. And anything that I can do to help Coach Hayda, you know, he's been a blessing to me and given me many opportunities. So I'll gladly continue with any role that he has for me.
That was Gage Porter on the touchdown, finding Cardenas again on just a little slip inside. And Indy, we'll keep you on just for the other series, just to get a little bit of chalk talk on alignments and stuff. But overall, how big has the progress been this spring in your evaluation?
I think it's been good. You know, the main thing about spring, you want to really develop those young guys. A lot of the time, you know, you see in a lot of programs, young guys in the fall, they're running a lot of scout team stuff based off the other opponent, right? So they don't really get a ton of work at what you actually do. And, it, you know, for an outsider, you maybe don't see it that way. But for the inside, from the inside out, it's really, hey, these guys haven't gotten a ton of reps at what we do other than fall camp, you know, because they're, like I said, they're running scout cards and working on scout teams. So you want to see growth there. And then you really want to, you know, Coach Hayda stresses so much leadership with our older guys. You want to see continual growth with those older guys. And I think we're in a good place there. You know, we've got a little bit of room to grow, but guys are keeping other guys accountable in the weight room and then on the practice field. You know, the expectation is what it is. And for us to be a great team, at some point it's got to be a player-led team. And Coach Hayda talks about it daily. And so seeing that growth within older guys and then young guys just getting more reps. They need reps within our scheme on both sides. And so I think it's been really good this spring. I've seen a lot of improvement on both sides.
Speaking of young guys, would you crown someone most improved? Or who would you crown most improved?
Yeah, that's a really good question. There's a lot of guys defensively that have taken steps. That's a really good question. Again, Jamari really stands out to me. He kind of played a little bit of inside last year, so moving him full-time to outside linebacker as a freshman, he's going to have a chance to be a really nice player for us. Other than that, you know, Josh Johnson, I know he's an older guy, but just seeing him continue to work every single day, you know, he's repping at three different positions right now for us on defense, which is a lot to take on. Kind of that nickel outside linebacker, he'll rep safety a lot today, and then also, you know, at corner, his traditional position. He's gotten a lot better. And then, you know, I've worked, you know, sparingly a little bit here and there with the defensive line. And that group as a whole, I think, is continuing to get better. Coach Price does a great job with them. You know, they work really hard in practice. And even, you know, a guy like Zach Tisdale, who hasn't played a ton for us, you can tell he's really made efforts in the weight room. He's added body weight. I think he's probably up 15 to 20 pounds. And then, you know, just thinking about it, Emmanuel Obina at inside linebacker, another freshman for us, he's shown some flashes during spring. I think he's going to be a really nice player for us as well.
Like Weston Smith on the carry up the middle. And so third and five situation here. Indy, what are we seeing from the defense in this situation?
Well, Coach Price is calling it right now, so we'll see what he does. You know, the really tough thing about our offense is they are so different than anything that we see. You do kind of have to have a plan for their perimeter game, you know, and then obviously athletic quarterback, you know, when Gage is out there, just the ability to ad lib. But their perimeter game is outstanding. You know, they're going to – perimeter blocking is something that they work daily, their bubble series, and then all the stuff that they can run off of that. You know, they'll run buck sweep and then work the perimeter game on the backside. It really puts your inside linebackers kind of in limbo, you know, defend the run front side. And then also, you know, they create so much space to the field. So each and every day that we, you know, we're in team settings or even a scrimmage like this, that's my number one concern. You know, just their ability to mesh play calls and get to the perimeter. They do a great job at scheming stuff up on that side of the ball.
Cameron Andrus gets it around the left side and lost the ball in the open field, and it's recovered by Jamari Johnson, who you've heaped a lot of praise on. And Indy, you'd love to see that right there with Trent Smith, veteran leader, telling Andrus,
absolutely,
you know, keep your head up. And, you know, it's, you know, fun and games, and obviously each squad's wanting to have the bragging rights here tonight. Is there anything on the line?
Not to my knowledge, no. I will say, to piggyback on that, though, you know, we talked about Eli. Trent's done a great job, too. You know, it's one thing to be a leader on the defense, but to be a leader of the whole team, you know, to really take that role, like you said, that was great that you saw that there. He's doing that stuff on the daily. I mean, that's something that I see from him all the time. You know, he's become more vocal, and we've needed it, so he's been great.
Well, Indy, we'll let you get back down. I'm sure you'll have some words of wisdom at halftime for your guys. So thanks for spending time with us and
absolutely
giving us some insight into the squad and what we're going to be looking forward to here in 22.
Most definitely. Hey, I appreciate it. Thanks for all you do, Luke.
You bet. Indy Sindel, SNU defensive coordinator, as Gage Porter takes that around the right side for a gain of 5. Again, coming up halftime / third quarter, we'll have head coach Dustin Hayda with us and cap off the evening with offensive line coach and special teams coordinator Nathan Brown. A lot of good stuff there from Indy, Sam.
Oh, absolutely. I loved how he gave out those shout-outs to those guys. You know, when you're in spring ball, you don't realize how much you have improved, and everybody improves at least a little bit. And to hear your coach give you praise, it means the world.
False start on the white team. We've seen a couple false starts from the white team. The white team also is the one leading 13-0 on the scoreboard, and they've gotten a couple takeaways as well from the Crimson squad. We'll see if the Crimson squad can rally in the second half. Down to 150 to play here in the opening half of the SNU spring game. In a beautiful evening, the wind isn't quite as blustery as it has been the past few days, or weeks, I should say. What a gorgeous night and a great crowd on hand for some good spring football. Quick slant over the middle, and that's going to be Jarrell Farr on the reception from Porter. And we'll definitely talk to Coach Hayda about this, but definitely seeing Porter in there a little bit more than Jarvis Davis tonight and just getting some more reps after that offseason shoulder surgery.
Yeah, and I just want to point out that was a great throw on the dime pass on a slant route. That was a perfect pass. And a good effort, good second effort by the receiver as well.
Middle of the field for the white squad, 1st and 10, 35-yard line, 1 minute to go. Nice 2-minute practice here. Porter pulls it out of the belly and runs it down to the 29-yard line. Nick Blanchard there along with Hiram Flores. We've called both of those guys' names several times this evening on the red defensive squad.
Yeah, they've kind of been all over the place making excellent plays. And that's what, you know, I'm sure Coach Indy loves to see is their guys flying around to the ball.
Same from a player's perspective, you've got to change at, you know, a leadership position like defensive coordinator. How big of a difference does it make that it's a familiar face who's just taking on a new role as opposed to a new guy coming in?
You know, it makes a pretty big difference. You generally already have confidence with this coach that he can do the job. And it's kind of awkward when you get someone freshly new. You're trying to feel each other out. Is he going to be a good coach? Is he not going to be a good coach? But I believe these guys already know that Coach Indy is the most excellent coach, and he really cares about these athletes.
Coach Hayden Uden is in a timeout there. So good. Again, good live game situation here. 50 seconds to go. White team looking for their third touchdown of the half. Been an active evening over here at the sports complex. You got Bethany High School soccer taking on Chickasha just across the visitor stands there. We had a baseball game that just wrapped up. Had some track practice over in the corner. So just a busy, active evening over here. Gotta love the spring season. An absolutely perfect day today. So two wide receivers right, one to the left for the white squad. Gage Porter wanting a play clock reset.
And he got it.
It was far in motion to the near side. Thomas is the back. Porter back to pass. Airs it out down the far side looking for Andrew Tisdale, and it's going to be incomplete.
Oh, I think that was a no-call pass interference.
Cam Wells out there.
Yeah. That defender turned around and put his hands in that guy's chest and drove him 3 yards.
Yeah, definitely looked like it might have been a little early there from this vantage point.
Just a little bit, but I'm not down there on the field to see exactly how early it was or if it was early.
Hey, spring game for the officials as well. We've got two guys out there at back judge, so we've got training practice on the spot for these guys as well. So it'll be third down and about four. Farr comes back in motion to the left side. Porter looking that way. Now he's directing traffic, slide steps, and finds Farr down the field at the 11-yard line. We've got a flag, though. Nick Blanchard indicating he might have been held.
Yeah, and that was a great catch by Jarrell Farr. I had a guy all over his back, and he still came down with it.
So we'll see what the call is here on the white squad, but it is going to be coming back. Don't think we're going to get an official indication one way or the other. It's a 5-yard penalty, so I think they must have got Farr for being ineligible man downfield, or someone ineligible downfield. That'll back it up. Make it 3rd and 9. 3rd and distance, not exactly a down and distance that SNU ever wants to be in offensively, Sam.
No. I think in the past we've always struggled on the 3rd down and longs. We're more of a, I'd say, a running team than a passing team. And anytime you get more than 5 yards out on a 3rd down when you have a running team, it makes it pretty difficult to pick up that 1st down.
Porter was spilled in the backfield by Marcus Sowell as tried to dump it off to Carlos Thomas. It looks like we're going to try a long field goal here for the white squad. So this is going to be a 51-yarder from the middle of the field for Ryan Reed, who pushed a 45-yarder a little bit wide right earlier.
Yeah, and he has the wind to his back, so that will be a great advantage.
Right dead center of the field here for Reed. Richard Sr. from Burleson, Texas. Got the distance, and again, just a little wide right. Both those kicks a little helicoptery. Yeah. But both of them had the distance just a little bit to the right.
Just hooked it just a little bit.
Athletic director Danny Thomason out there playing ball guy, fetching those. Could work on the distance on the underhand toss, though. So the red squad, or crimson squad rather, will get a crack at this with 21 and a half seconds to play in the half. Jarvis Davis back out there after a series from Bryson Evans. Three wide to the right, going into the breeze. Davis rolls right, throws it, looking for Donovan Hill. And it was just over the outstretched hands of Jamari Johnson, who Coach Sindel mentioned a lot, and we've called his name a lot here tonight.
Yeah, and I don't know if that was a good pass to throw. He had a guy in front and behind him, so he would have had to fit that in a perfect window.
We've got a flag. And it's going to be a chop block here on the Crimson offense. So that'll back him up 15 yards. 17 seconds to go in the quarter.
Did they change the rules on that in the past couple years?
No, I think that's always been 15.
No, I mean the block. Because I think before you could throw a block outside the tackle box.
Well, I think it was the combo, high-low, or two guys chop block. It's typically what that indication is. Davis rolling to his left, looking for help, finds Zepeda running out of the backfield, and he's chopped down at the original line of scrimmage by Lionel Lucas.
And that was a big hit by Lucas.
And Lucas, one of those graduate seniors from the Bronx, New York. I believe we got a timeout by the Crimson squad with 3 seconds left. Squeezing every last second out of these 10-minute quarters.
You thinking it's going to be a Hail Mary pass, or you think it's going to be something simple?
I would imagine it'll be something simple just with the wind blowing in their face a little bit. I'd asked Coach Hayda what the format was for tonight earlier this week, and you know, he told me, and it was like, okay, so we're not going to do anything like Bob Stoops used to do at OU. It's like 2 minutes into the fourth quarter. We're done. Call it. We're done. He was like, no, probably not. In fact, if the based on the speed of the game, they might extend the fourth quarter to 15 minutes. But how the second quarter's gone, I would imagine that they'll just keep it at 10. But I could be wrong. We'll ask him here coming up in a few minutes. Davis, slant to Donovan Hill. Goes through his hands. It's incomplete up at the 45-yard line. That's how the first half will end here in Bethany with the white team with a 13-0 lead over the Crimson squad. So we'll take a break, and when we come back, we'll have head coach Dustin Hayda with us. Talk to him about his thoughts of this game, of the spring, and just the direction of his program as he embarks on year number 2 in Bethany. We'll be back after this break. This is SNU Football.
Hello and welcome to our broadcast. My name is Danny Thomason and I am the Director of Intercollegiate Athletics here at Southern Nazarene University. You know, we compete in 16 varsity sports in Division II NCAA, and we could not pull that off without the help of a lot of wonderful sponsors. And so we would like to take this opportunity during the broadcast to say thank you, thank you, thank you to so many of our wonderful sponsors that help make our athletic competitions possible. So thank you, and enjoy the remainder of the broadcast. Bolts up.
All right, welcome back. We are ready to start the third quarter. The 2022 Crimson and White spring game for Southern Nazarene football. Luke McConnell and Sam Perkins with you. It's dusting off the gridiron call here as we get set for football in September. Schedule is out. You can check that out on snuathletics.com. Ryan Reed sends that one away. It's going to be Andrus who fields it inside the five. Andrus picking his way across the 15. He's taking down Trent Smith there along with Blade Horton and Ethan Miner. Well covered there by the Crimson Storm special teams. Coach Destin Hayden making his way through the crowd. Forgot there wasn't an aisle on the other side. Picks his way through the crowd to come join us for a little bit of this third quarter and talk football, talk the SNU program. Sam, what stood out to you so far, though, this evening?
I'd say the White offense has really stuck out to me. Obviously, they've scored twice, but they've shown little spurts of greatness, especially at the quarterback position. They made a couple excellent throws, and receivers have done a great job catching and running, making yards off of the catch.
Jarvis Davis on the screen pass to number 30, Trey Leap, sophomore from Oklahoma City. And, well, he squeezed that one in there. I did not think there was a window there for Davis to throw that with a man right in his face. That'll be second down and seven for the Crimson squad. And we've got Coach Hayda with us. And, Coach Hayda, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
Your thoughts on the evening thus far? Gorgeous night for football.
It is, man. It's the wind's not blowing finally, so it's what we've kind of been waiting on. There you go.
Carlos Cepeda with the carry up to the 24-yard line. And, Coach Hayda, as you look back at last season for your program, what stands out to you, the big building blocks that you're using from last year going forward into this season?
Big time, just trying to clean stuff up. It doesn't look like it tonight, but, you know, we're trying to clean up penalties, be more efficient in the red zone, and, you know, be better on third down with both sides of the football. Tackle better. And that's really what we've been working on.
As far as the spring goes, how has spring practice go? How has it gone? How important is spring practice to the overall health of your program and any program for that matter?
That's a hit right there. Oh, it's important, man. We've had a great job of being really healthy. Let's see what Coach West does here.
Is he as aggressive as you on fourth
down? I don't know. We're fitting on finding out. Oh, yeah. He's going for it. Let's see what he does.
When he was up here with us in that first series, you didn't go for it. And he was like, oh, I thought I think you know a guy.
No, it's been really good for our team, and we've gained a lot of experience and a lot of depth, and the young guys have developed like we thought. The old guys have really led. Oh, I like it.
Carlos Cepeda breaking in like the open field.
Oh, you better go, Carlos. They're coming.
Inside the 20 before Trent Smith and Josh Johnson finally track him down inside the 15-yard line.
That's a great run. But no, we've done a good job with those young guys getting a ton. So we split every rep. So, you know, we give everybody equal reps and equal time to really get evaluated, get a lot of film, and we spend a lot of time teaching and coaching them. The young guys that may not have played a ton last year, so the development for our guys has been really, really good this year, especially for those young cats and just fine tuning the older guys for sure.
You talked a lot about just how big that COVID year was, as disappointing as it was, how big it was for those young guys. And, you know, sounds like you're really seeing that play out as Davis takes it around the right side before going out of bounds at about the 6.
Yeah, it's helping us out. I was looking at next year's stuff already and just seeing where we were trying to do classifications on guys. And it's a madhouse figuring out semesters and where guys are with their eligibility. And I think I finished up counting. We're going to have 16 guys in graduate school, which is really, really exciting for the program. And I think Beyond those 16, there's going to be five additional graduates at semester. And so we've got a, you know, those guys are getting educated. That should be a touchdown.
Davis fighting for the goal line.
Those guys are getting educated. We're getting a ton of dudes out of here with bachelor's degrees and master's degrees while they're, you know, finishing up their eligibility still. So it's been – that COVID was really a blessing. And then on the football field, you know, those – there's a lot of young faces out here that played some played a lot last year that had to, and that it's gonna really show up this year and the next year when those guys get, you know, into their sophomore and junior years. But they played a ton of ball and just gotten a ton better and developed.
Sam, anything for Coach Ada?
Yeah, Coach. Which groups have improved the most, both on offense and defense?
Man, I tell you what, our inside linebacking core, that was a really good drive. Our inside linebacking core has gotten so much better under the leadership of Cole Cizik and Dylan Bauer and Josh Lopez. They've brought some young guys along with them that has improved so much and just gotten really more deep and consistent. And then really at outside backer, we had, you know, we lost a lot graduation to outside linebacker. And those young cats, man, Obina at inside, and then Dave Omasigo's done a great job at outside as a young guy that's just kind of getting his go. And it's been – outside backer's been really good. Depth at wide receiver has been really developed in this offseason with some young guys. And Joa transferring in has been a really nice spark for us. Colby being back from injury from last year is a good spark for us. And Fellows is healthy. Asa had been healthy all of spring. He'll be back full go, but – wide receiver, the future is really bright, and our depth is really good. And so I've been really impressed with them.
Gage, obviously out last year a lot with that shoulder injury. How did he use that time out to grow?
Man, he's a – I didn't call like six of the plays he was in. He just said, I got it, and he went and called them. So, you know, he knows the offense so well that – you know, there's a lot of trust there with and he knows what he can do and what he can't. And so I think that was the biggest deal. He would sit at home and listen to our road games last year, and when we get back, he'd say, Coach, I called 70% of that stuff that you called at the same time. So he used that really to fine-tune his knowledge of the offense, and really he's on the same page as me on a lot of stuff, and so that's really good. But I think he's developed more as a positive vocal leader for our offense. And you know, that's something. He was always a good player, and he was always an example guy. But he's really stepped up in his positive vocal leadership this year, and it's been really good.
On your staff, you promoted Indy Sindel to defensive coordinator. Was that an easy choice for you?
Yeah, absolutely. Indy's – I love him to death. He works hard. Shows great initiative. He's on board with what we're doing. No doubt in my mind, you know, he's kind of worked his way up through the ranks, man. He was a GA here, then he was full-time, and now he's coordinating. So he's done a really good job. He's poured into it, and just he's detail-oriented. He works really hard, and man, he's a focused leader too.
I asked Sam this from the player's perspective, how important is that continuity as opposed to bringing in a new guy with new ideas and different voice? How big is that? Have you seen that is a positive impact to have a familiar guy now being the leader?
Yeah, I think so. I think it helped. I think it helped this spring to not have to, you know, change every single thing that we were doing schematically. There have been some changes, but at the same time, you know, some of the base terminology at least is the same, so I think that helps. And you know, Indy's got his players love him, and they respond to him really well, and he knows how to communicate. And I think that was a big thing for him. They respond to him well.
Coach, we'll let you take us through this second down play, second down and 9 after Porter gains 1 up to the 36-yard line. And Obina, as you mentioned earlier, is a young guy who stood out in there on the tackle as well.
Yeah, he's doing a great job this spring, and man, I'm excited to see him go in the Great American Conference even as a young dude. You know, we got who's out there right now on D. So Eli's running the show in the back end. Cam's down here playing boundary corner. Those guys have played a ton of football and done a really nice job of just really stepping up cultural leaders this year. It's been fun. He needs to get loose on that. That's good. Brandon Perez is healthy and back. Edyon Bada, number 8. He played some at the end of the year. Really at our tight end position, that's one thing that's really unique. So at the tight end position, we've got 3 tight ends that are varsity-level dudes right now. And, you know, we dabbled in some of that last year, and we'll play it a bunch this year. Our jumbo package with 3 tight ends gives us a little bit of an advantage personnel-wise. And we can still get the ball downfield on it. But with having Edyon there, he's split out wide. He's just a versatile dude. He's long and understands what we're doing offensively and does a really nice job. Can do everything. That's another doggone penalty. So it's the 14th practice. Every time we go in motion for 14 practices, the defense yells our check. And tonight – those O linemen act like they've never heard it before, and they jump. They fall start every time that the defense yells our check to change our blitz and slant. So that's a little disheartening. But
we were curious if it had anything to do with Peyton cutting his mullet.
You know, I thought he jinxed himself right out of the gate, and then he had a couple really good days, so I forgave him. I sure missed that ponytail, but I think he'll pop out of it.
It's 2nd and 11. Back of the 34s. Porter rolls left, directing traffic. Floats it in the middle. A little behind Jarrell Farr there.
Speaking of your O-line, Coach, have they improved over the spring?
They really have, and so it's a great mix right now. So Andy Cardenas is going to be back from that Achilles from last year. So he started all those COVID games as a true freshman. And then he started the first 2 games and then tore that – or he didn't tear it, but really hurt that Achilles and was out. And so it'll be nice to have him back. He's full go. Morale – and he's just a freshman. David Morales is going to be the other tackle. Started as a freshman last year and has really grown and developed as he should in his second year. And then you've got the old guys. So you got Braden Jones and Grayson Winters holding it down. They've been doing it for a really long time. And Grayson and him, they're just versatile dudes. They can play all the positions up front. They know everything on the offense and can communicate it well and are really good. And then, you know, we got graduated Joey at center. And so really it's Bates has – or Cizik has snapped a ton. Braden Jones – when Braden Jones snaps, then Cole Cizik, who played a ton last year as a freshman, he's going to be piecing in. But we're a little bit deeper right now, and we're a good mix of really old and really young, actually. So there's the all-region punter. Good. So, yeah, I like the way the O-line's going right now.
And wide receiver, you lose Reed. Roloss, finally.
Yeah.
Seems like he's been was here forever, of course. But who has kind of stepped up into that go-to guy at wide receiver, or is that a by-committee approach with
this
offense?
It's by-committee, but the committee's gotten better. So, mm-hmm. And there's more in the committee. So that's been a tremendous blessing. So Joa Flores transferred in from New Mexico, University of New Mexico, where he was a freshman. Through that COVID year and stuff. And so he's been a great addition at our slot. We really feel like, man, there's 5 slots right now that we've got that are going to play and play a ton, which is important in our jet and bubble game. They can all block and go. Make him miss, Bryson. And then on the outside, you know, Asa Robertson's played really well. He tweaked his hamstring, didn't really pull it or strain or anything, but he played really well early and has continued to do that. Brandon Perez has been here for a long time. He's doing good things. Colby Branch is back from injury, so he had that nerve thing going on, whatever. But he's back, and he's really been playing well this spring. Tisdale's back on the outside. And then really a young guy that stepped up this spring has been Donovan Hill, kind of an unassuming dude. He's long, but just a quiet, unassuming guy. And man, he's had a great spring, and he's blocking his tail off and running the right stuff and catching the ball. It's been really good. So there's a little screen. Let's see what Donnie does. Incomplete.
This is Donald May, redshirt freshman from Ardmore. The intended receiver there on the screen from Evans.
You know, Donnie's another one. So Donald May's another kid that at that slot position that's really played really well this spring. And he redshirted last year and was just learning the offense. We knew he had the physical ability to be really, really good. And so now that he's got some reps under his belt and has spent some time in the playbook with formations and motions, he's doing a really nice job. He had a setback with his hamstring, but so this is really his first day back in about 4 days. But he's an exciting one too.
It would seem that level of depth, that level of competition at a certain position seems like a coach's dream, where you can tell everyone, no, really, if you don't do your job, someone else is literally going to take your spot.
Yeah, it is. But you know what? Those guys are going to coach each other up. They're going to encourage each other, the guys that are in front of them. And shoot, you'd never tell that they're competing for position. They're encouraging one another, and they're coaching each other to be the best that they can be at those positions. And guys that are ahead of them in the depth chart are getting coached by guys behind them, and vice versa. And it's really, really good. They're all on the same page. They all got the same goals. Penalty free, move the football, ball security, and block really well in the perimeter. And so they encourage one another as they're fighting like mad to be the starting guys. And they're a supportive group. And Coach West does a great, great job of just building that camaraderie and getting those guys to believe in one another and help them be their best.
Last one for you. We talked a lot last year just about not speculating on opponents or things like that. In schedule, same order, just flip-flopped on location. When you look at your squad as it stands right now, how you feel that kind of breaks for you as far as, stretch, you can get on a good roll and things like that?
Nah, there's none of that. We got to play great football. We got block dudes on the perimeter. We got to stop on third down. We got to cover without penalty. We got to be efficient in the red zone, and we've got to be penalty free and take care of the football. So it doesn't matter. The order doesn't matter. It's all the same stuff. Shoot, we've been doing this thing forever, so the order's really irrelevant in my mind. But we just got to play. We just got to play great football. I mean, guys got to just where we left off last year. We've got to be more efficient in the red zone. We got to take care of the football. We got to be penalty free. We got to cover and get off the field on third down,
Coach. Thank you very much for your time. It's been great. Thanks for the insight into how things are going. We look forward to the continued growth and a great 2022 season.
Man, I appreciate you guys. And Luke, it's good to see you in a spring. It's good to see Big Sammy P back. Good to have him back in the saddle again.
He drove all the way down
again
from Tulsa for this.
He's the man, and he's a legend around these parts. Let me tell you the legend of Sammy Perkins. I'm taking the time to do it. We went to Monticello. We played at Monticello. Long, long trip. Sammy P. We had two other linemen were out with injury. Sammy P. went in. Mud game. Thought he had a bone bruise in the first quarter. We go into the locker room. 3-hour rain delay. Trainer's prodding on it. Doesn't feel great. Thinks he has a bone bruise. Well, the option was Will Bates could break his red shirt. Or Sammy could keep playing. And so we came out of a 3-hour rain delay. Sammy Perkins went in, finished the game. We got the x-ray on that, that Sunday night. And he had completely fractured his, what was it, Sammy, the tibia?
The fibula.
Fibula. Shattered that thing and splintered it out, and he played 3 quarters on it. Oof. So that one guy didn't have to burn his red shirt. And so around these parts, man, he's a legend. I still got the x-ray on my phone. Any old lineman wants to gripe about their finger or something, I just whip that x-ray out and I say, look, this is the legend of Sammy Perkins. So, man, it's great to see you guys, and I appreciate all you do for us.
You bet, Coach. Our pleasure. Flores on the outside, and he's wrestled down just short of the line of scrimmage, so it'll be fourth down here for the white squad as the Crimson Storm is the Crimson squad is bowed up defensively here in the second half, Sam, and shut the white team out and gotten a few three and outs as well.
That's what I love to see at a spring game. Both guys competing hard and, playing great football. Defensive really hasn't had that many penalties, if any, and they're playing clean, hard football.
Disappointed Indy didn't have the insight as to whether there's anything on the line for this game between the players or anything. You got to think there's something on the line, right?
There's probably something on the line, but
maybe some dinner or something. You know, probably, nothing too crazy.
Probably can't admit that on the air.
High hanging punt for Ryan Reed comes down to Flores at the 28-yard line. So the Crimson Squad offense getting back in business here with 57 seconds to go in the quarter. Just a reminder, we'll have Coach Nathan Brown up here with us for the final stanza. And yes, there will be some more O-line talk as he commandeers the offensive line group as well as the special teams group. So we'll have some, if you like O-line play, we'll have some more of that here in just a little bit.
Yeah, and it was great to have Coach Hayda up here. You know, he hasn't changed a bit. He's always full of energy and excited about football.
Davis escapes the pressure, lost the football on the pressure from behind.
White came up with it.
Trying to see who made the play out there for the White squad. I think it was Billy Monroe, number 33, from behind with the strip sack after. Davis had gotten away from, I believe it was Milik Ritchie out there with the initial pressure up the middle. But Billy Monroe with the strip and the White offense back in business inside the 30-yard line. That's the third turnover forced by the White defense this evening. They turned one of those into a touchdown. See former SNU safety Josh Jordan out there. Couple alums down here on the sideline taking in the evening festivities. Dorian Harris, cornerback on last year's squad, out there with a headset on as well, helping coach the young guys up as well. Perez, the man in motion, gets it, flips it back to Jarrell Farr, trying to get outside, evades a couple tacklers before finally being brought down at the 30-yard line. Grayson Tomberlin, redshirt freshman from Waurika, was in the backfield in a hurry, and he forced Farr way back beyond the 40-yard line and then eventually made the tackle.
Yeah, I think if we were playing an actual team who didn't know our plays, I think that play would have broke out. There was a couple guys that were lingering in the back just waiting on it.
So it looks like Coach Hayda is going to let the final seconds tick down here in the third quarter. 14-7, the White lead the Crimson Squad. So we'll have one more. I believe we'll probably just still keep this to a 10-minute quarter. And that'll be the case. And so Coach Brown going over a few things before he comes up and joins us. But same, we really have across the board, we've called a lot of young guys' names tonight.
Absolutely.
And some of that is, a little bit of that is just, you know, you divide the squad naturally, you're going to have young guys who are going to have to, you know, step out there and be on the field maybe more than you would if you were playing Wichita Baptist tonight.
Yeah.
But they have been all over the place.
Well, a spring game is all about getting all these young guys lots of reps. It's not so much for your veterans, but, I mean, of course you want to get them a few reps as well, but this is really for younger guys showing out really for the first time.
So final stands upcoming. Coach Nathan Brown making his way up to the booth to join us for a little chalk talk as well. It'll be White team football, second and 11 from the 29-yard line. And Bryson Evans taking over at quarterback here, getting some reps on this side, going toward the north end zone here in the fourth quarter. Carlos Thomas is the back behind Evans. And he gets the carry around the right side. Nearly broke through the hole, but taken down around the ankles by Cole Cizik. Heard Coach Hayden mention him. Graduate senior from Elgin. And he and Dylan Bauer man in the middle of that defense. At the linebacker position, they know things inside and out at this point. So it'll be third down and 8 from the 24-yard line. Far the man in motion. Evans turns and gives to Thomas. In trying to find the hole, it closes quickly, and then he's plowed down at the 24-yard line. Paul Thonsgard, redshirt freshman from Hardin, Texas, in on the tackle. So it'll be 4th and 6 for the white squad, and we'll see another go for it here. We're joined now by Coach Nathan Brown. Coach Brown, thanks for joining us this evening.
No problem.
Coach Brown, your thoughts on tonight so far, what you've seen out of your guys?
Well, offensive line-wise, we should probably stop jumping off sides. That'd be helpful. So, but other than that, I mean, that's just some nervousness and all that type of stuff. But they've come a long way. I mean, if we could see film of the beginning of spring ball till now, they're doing a whole lot better, so I'm proud of them.
And going back to last year, Coach Brown, you had a offensive line that started 2 freshman tackles, dealt with a bunch of injuries. Just you look back, how did you evaluate just what you guys went through along the line last year?
Yeah, I mean, that was tough. And even with that, we had some additional injuries just here and there that we were able to cover up some. But, yeah, with the freshmen and really with when you look at it, essentially wound up starting 3 freshmen over the course of that year with those COVID freshman guys. But, I mean, the good thing for them was they got a lot of game experience. They got to learn a lot about, you know, what the GAC has to offer. I mean, we can tell them that all we want, but they got to experience firsthand, so they're ready to go now. So,
this is your second season at SNU. What brought you down here to join Coach Hayda's staff last year?
Well, Coach Hayda and I played together at Mid-America, and and then we also coached for about 10 years at Olivet together. And during our time there, we always kind of said, you know, if one of us ever got a head job, we'd get the other one with us. And he got this job here, and he asked me if I wanted to come down and join him. And we were excited to do that. My wife, so I had actually taken a couple years and been in school administration, and my wife was ready for me to get back into coaching, so it worked out well that way too. So,
man, normally it's the opposite.
Yeah, no, she likes it too. She loves the game, and we're pretty happy, and we love Oklahoma. We love SNU, so it's been a good transition for us.
Along the offensive line, you hear coaches talk about how it's not always, you know, the 5 best guys as far as raw talent goes. It's the guys that fit best together as a unit. You know, how do you feel on that offensive line philosophy, and how has that played out with this bunch?
Well, and I think even some of that gets shown a little bit tonight. We practice in groups, and I mix them up some in practice, but for the most part, they've stayed with their groups. And so if you saw practice versus tonight, it's just some of the little things that we're not doing well here. It's because they're not used to working together. And I'd say that's absolutely true. Just an offensive line, it's 5 guys, but it's one unit type deal. And so it's definitely, you have to be able to trust the guy behind you, know what they're going to do in certain situations and that type of deal. And so I would say that holds absolutely true. And with those injuries last year, that kind of showed itself a little bit there too, just because those guys were feeling themselves out sometimes week to week.
So, mm-hmm. But Sam, what you got?
Well, I got a question for you. How are the drills going during spring practice?
Well, that's been a positive part of it, and really, I do the drills, and they kind of sometimes say, "Hey, can we be a little bit more physical?" Which is a good thing, and that's something that Coach Hayden and I've been harping on with them about is just their overall physicality and just kind of getting that mentality as an offensive line and making that who we're known for. And so they've done a good job there. They've obviously you're always trying to work technique, but they want to mix in that physical aspect of it too. So that's been a promising part of it, and I'm hoping that carries forward into next year as well.
And if you had to pick one to say who is the most improved on your O-line, who would it be?
Oh, most improved. I mean, through this spring right now, probably Will McCune. He'll be a, I think, redshirt freshman. Gets all confused with all these extra years in here, but I think he'll be a redshirt freshman. But he, I mean, he's come probably the furthest of any of those guys this spring. He struggled a little bit with some pad level issues and those type of things, but this spring, especially these last 2 weeks here, he's really kind of fixed that. Unfortunately, dislocated his finger tonight, but he's taped that up and he's back in. I'm not sure if I'm allowed to say that. So
oh, I love you.
Anyway. Hey, as long as the coaches say it, it's fine.
There you go. Yeah.
If we said it, we'd be I maybe think, get a call later.
Well, he kept waving around in the air, so I think everybody saw that it was out.
It's kind of flopping in the breeze.
Yep.
Yeah, we don't have the flags on the goalpost, but we do have Will's finger flapping in the wind
correct.
Tonight.
Yep.
So.
Yep.
Coach Brown, you handle the special teams as well, and you know, it's certainly an area that you know a lot of people maybe would overlook. Is like, ah, it's a fair catch, no big deal. But you know, special teams just it's another one of the three areas of football in an area that you could can really harp on and take advantage of in a lot of situations.
Yep, and that's something that we have some plans, we have some things that we practice, and really we just never really got into some game situations last year where we could do it. And so we'll keep working those type of things. But you're exactly right. We Coach Hayda's philosophy really is we want that to be an active part of what we're trying to do. And so we want it to be a potential game changer type event as well. So we have some things that hopefully this next year we can get into and utilize a little bit more just to keep teams honest but also give ourselves an advantage as well.
Obviously, kicker, you've got the most – obvious part of the special teams, and you've got the veteran in Ryan, and then you've got the young guy in Ray. How have those two guys come along and made each other better?
Well, yeah, and definitely tonight's. I mean, Ray's kicks obviously had a little bit of wind, but not a whole lot. But I mean, he was putting those deep in the end zone, and so that's a good addition in that regard. He was doing that towards the end of last year, and so he's obviously carrying that forward there. And then also Ryan, I mean, he's usually pretty consistent on that first punt here tonight. He pulled his head. I was actually standing behind him, and I watched him, and I said, were you trying to see how far it'd go? And he said, yeah. So, obviously, in a game situation, he's pretty consistent on that. And so, but the one thing I really appreciate about those guys, I give them a plan before practice and say, here's the things I want you to work on. And they're pretty accountable, and they show good integrity. They do a lot of their own work on their own. And it kind of shows up on Saturdays, shows up in situations like this where you can see they haven't just been taking days of practice off or anything like that. They do a good job. And the other piece of it too, so after they get that done, they come down, they help us offense and defensively by spotting the ball and just doing things to help us keep practice running smoothly. So they do a good job with that as well.
As far as return guys, Coach Hayda mentioned just the depth that you guys have at wide receiver, has that translated over and as far as returners options as well?
Yeah, and so last year, obviously, Josh Johnson was, again, talking about injuries, so he had that injury early on, and then we got him back, and obviously he helped the return game a ton. But one of the things that we kind of wanted to get a little bit better at was our punt return, and so Joe Flores comes in as a transfer, so he helps us there. And then some of those DBs that didn't do it last year have kind of stepped up and really gotten good at it. So I'm excited about our punt return game as well, kind of just adding on some things that we didn't necessarily have last year. So we're looking forward to that.
Porter with a nice deep throw hauled in by Brandon Perez down at the 25-yard line. And good to see Gage Porter uncorking the arm. Shoulder looks pretty good there, Coach.
Yeah, it does. So that's another thing. So, I mean, yeah, his arm and his physical ability and all that type of stuff is great. But just his leadership, it's good to have him back. And he's a competitor, and it's good to have a guy like that on your team. So,
Coach Hayda mentioned last year that you're quite the experimenter when it comes to different drink combinations as far as mix-ins and flavors and things like that. Walk us through your process as a mixologist there.
Yeah, so mainly I just take things and I mix them together. But and then I actually found one that stuck. we called it Pink Lady Punch growing up, but basically the punch you drink at weddings. And we found a good combination of Mountain Dew and Blackberry Lemonade. And so if Walmart would like to sponsor me, I'd be happy with that. But definitely, so that's what – and a lot of times the coaches ask me to mix them one up as well. So we do that. My wife's not too wild about the abundance of Mountain Dew I drink, but – we'll let that filter itself out.
There you go. Coach, thanks so much for your time, and looking forward to seeing you guys continue to grow as a program, and looking forward to a great 22 season.
We are too. I appreciate you having me. Thank you.
Coach Nathan Brown, offensive line and special teams coordinator for the Crimson Storm, as the white squad first and 10 inside the 15 as Porter swings that out to Perez. He gets down to the 10-yard line, and same, just a lot of really good insights to the squad tonight with the coaches. I really appreciate them sharing all that with us, because as you and I both know, coaches can be notoriously closed-lipped when it comes to strategy and injuries and everything in between. But a lot of good insights here tonight.
Yeah, they didn't reveal too much about injuries. I mean, that one slipped up. We won't say nothing about that, but yeah.
We've got second down at the 11-yard line here for the white squad. You know, and Sam, we talked a lot about the O-line in various capacities, but with a running offense like SNU's, the O-line is kind of key as far as making sure everything works, especially with just the intricacies of SNU's offense.
Yes, and I'd like to point out the importance of third down with the O-line. You know, as I played here, whenever it was third and eight or more, it got a little demoralizing because, you know, not every play is going to pop big. So as an offensive line coach and player, really your first two plays are some of the most important plays, you know, first down, second down, are your most important plays to set up for that third down. Because, as I said, not a lot of plays pop off, and your average run play are going to go 2-3 yards at best. And so, yeah.
So, I mean, third down and one from just inside the 5-yard line. The white team trying to get a first down, make a first and goal. Try to maybe ice this one for bragging rights. Porter's going to keep it himself up the middle, and he's in for the touchdown.
That was a great run by Gage Porter. He lowered his shoulder and went on in. And he is pumped up.
Letting the Crimson squad hear about it, which we've seen. You know, it's good to have the competition aspect, and it's, you know, honest personal opinion, it makes these games more fun to have the true divided teams where you're not saying, okay, now you go over there, work with this unit, where you treat it more as a practice than a game. And I mean, we've had a full on game atmosphere, and they've white team across the field waving at the Crimson squad. I mean, yeah, it's fun. It's competition. You got to love it.
Absolutely. I mean, we are talking about college athletes after all. I mean, everybody wants to win. So, I mean, even though they're on the same team, it's fair game whenever you're playing against each other.
So we've got 3:29 to go here in the ball game, and white squad out to run a two-point conversion. Bryson Evans is the quarterback out there, three wide to the right. The umpires step in real fast, and now they back out.
Yeah, and I've been real impressed with Bryson Evans. He had a couple good passes early on, and two or three good runs as well. Really showed out a little bit in the spring game.
Swung that out to Flores. Couldn't find any space, so the two-point try falls short. So the white team retains a 20-7 lead with 3:29 to play. We'll see what the Crimson squad can do, and I know from a situational perspective, I'm sure Coach Ada is hoping the Crimson squad can go down, get a touchdown so he can run through an onside kick situation. Always thinking about the reps.
Yeah, at this point you can work on your onside situation and your two-minute drill. How fast can you get down the field and score at the last minute? Spring games are always, you know, you always add something like that in there. And it really tests your play calling abilities and your players.
So it'll be Ryan Reed to send this one away with Flores and I think that's Andrus back there to receive. Spring game's always such a tease, Sam, because we get to, like, all right, football. And we're like, oh, wait, four more months.
Yeah, well, spring game always let me know that summer was right around the corner, and that was when we really got to work.
Yes.
You know, you have all these practices before games, and you have the season, but your real work for football happens in the summer.
Yeah, those conditioning workouts, yeah, everything about it.
Yep. There's a quote that says football is won in games in the off season, and that is 100% true. If you go into a season and you didn't work out, it's going to show, and if you get enough people on your team doing that, you won't win games. And I've seen it over and over.
Yeah, absolutely. And then, you know, the time together as well. In those workouts, you know, obviously not a situation where everybody is here all summer long or anything, you know, but those times, the guys you are around, you gain that camaraderie and grow a lot as well, not just physically.
Yeah, you definitely grow a bond with your teammates when you work out with them. You run, you share blood, sweat, and tears together. You just can't hardly beat anything like it.
Christian Gockel on the carry around the outside, and he's unceremoniously ushered out of bounds at the right at the sticks. That'll be a first down. Gockel, a redshirt freshman from Wilburton, Oklahoma. Healthy dose of Oklahoma and Texas across the SNU roster with a few outside states sprinkled in, but primarily a lot of Oklahoma and Texas guys out here. Evans back to pass. Out to the outside. Pass was a little low for Angel Ramirez coming out of the backfield. Flag in the backfield. We'll see what this one's about. And it's going to be a hold on the red team. Crimson team, excuse me. Team, you mentioned Evans had impressed you, and he really has been really decisive with those passes. Those are his passes that he's throwing, especially the quick ones. They're coming out quick, and they're on time. Accuracy maybe is lacking in some areas, like that one right there, a little bit low. But the timing has been pretty good from Evans, it seems.
Yeah, he's still young, so he probably hasn't gotten a lot of reps with these receivers. And over time, that'll change. He'll know right where he needs to put it, and it'll be a lot better and cleaner.
Evans rolls right here on 2nd and 20. Getting to the sideline, and he chased down and tripped up by Milik Ritchie from his defensive line position. Ritchie listed as a sophomore here from Ardmore. He's another one of those guys that eligibility-wise might be sophomore, but as far as his number of years on campus, anything but sophomore.
Yeah, he looked pretty good there. Ran right down the line and caught up with the quarterback.
So it'll be 3rd and 19. Crimson squad needs to get out to the 45-yard line. 2:30 and counting. We had the white squad leaning 20-7 this evening. Evans back to pass, steps right, throws it outside to Gockel, and they say incomplete. Looked like he made a really impressive catch, but unable to do so. So now it's third down. As the chain game on the far side, a little off on the down marker, but that's all right.
Yeah,
Austin, spring practice for everyone.
Austin Martin made a great move at nose guard and put a swim move on that center to get through and cause a little bit of disruption.
Jeremy Alcorn there at the defensive end spot near us also has had a nice night. Evans back to pass, flushed, and airmailed it a little bit over Angel Ramirez. So that'll bring up fourth down for the Crimson squad.
Yeah, we were talking about his ability to get out there. Well, he needed to take a little off on that one.
Indeed. Sometimes the ones that are the most open are the toughest to hit, it seems.
Absolutely. It just seems so easy, and then one mistake while you're throwing that ball, and it's all downhill from there.
Well, and from our vantage point and from anybody watching at home, you're thinking, how can you miss that guy? And the speed just does not translate.
Oh, yeah.
Whatever the level is, high school, college, pro, the speed just does not translate. It is impossible to really see how fast those guys really are going.
Oh, my goodness. So those guys are going really fast, especially on the offensive line perspective. I was 330 pounds at tackle position, and then you're trying to block a 220-pound guy or a 180-pound corner who's blitzing. The speed is just tremendously different than a high school game or junior high game. You really can't even compare it. Plus, just the athleticism from some of these guys. You know, we have a couple of players go to the NFL from the GAC, and those guys are just gifted athletes. And, you know, your average player has a really hard time blocking those guys for obvious reasons.
So in the timeout, fourth down for the Crimson squad. Just a reminder, the schedule for this year against the same as last year as far as the order, just flip-flopped home and away. So SNU with the six road games this season as part of the Great American Conference schedule. We start off at home, 6 o'clock kick here in Bethany for Arkansas Monticello on September 1st. And then all other Saturday contests, SNU will travel to Ouachita and play at home against East Central before a two-game road swing at Southeastern. Down the field for Ramirez. He made the catch, but out of bounds.
Yep, just
pretty close there, but it looked like he did hit out of bounds before he had secured the catch.
Yeah, just barely had 1 foot out of bounds when he came down with that ball.
But a really nice throw there, and a really nice catch from Ramirez out of the backfield as well. So the two-game road swing at Southeastern at Arkansas Tech brings us into October before three home games in a four-game stretch against Harding, sandwiched around a road trip to Southwestern, and then home games against Northwestern and Henderson State, and SNU finishes the season on the road at Southern Arkansas and Oklahoma Baptist. So you know the schedule, you know the opponents year in and year out. Was it ever disappointing that there was never any variety to the opponents? Like, for example, SNU played UCO in the spring last year, and it'd be the first time that they ever met, and unless things change schedule-wise, the only time they'll ever meet on the football field.
Yeah, I would have loved to have played other D2 schools just to see what's kind of out there and how tough their conferences are. Ours is pretty tough, I'm not going to lie. You got Harding, who is an unstoppable offensive machine when they get rolling. And you got teams like Ouachita, who is great not only on offense but on defense as well. And, yeah, but going back to your question, I would have loved to have played other schools.
Clock stops, 1:08 to play White squad inside the 20-yard line. Looking for more with a 20-7 lead. And Sam, going back to your time here, what always stands out to you? When you think about your time at SNU, what stands out the most to you from the football perspective?
Oh, man. The coaches here is really what stuck out to me. When I was here, you know, it was Coach Lambert. He always had these long meetings before every practice. But he always had a lot of good things to say in those practices and in those meetings, such as praising guys. He always praised us when we did something good, and he'd coach you up and let you know we did something bad, but he wasn't just all over you screaming at you. He was always giving you praise and trying to lift you up and keep your energy up. And that's something I really took out of here, was you don't have to be screaming at someone to teach them something. Something else I took out of SNU is just how to be durable and tough, not just in football but in life. I mean, we talked about my injury, and yeah, you might get hurt, but if you can keep going, you need to keep going, because if you do that at work, in real life, good things will happen.
Bryson Evans, quarterback in this group as well. Thomas is the back, 3rd and 3. He gives it to Thomas, and he plows his way forward, and he's going to be close. And I think they're going to give him a timeout called by the Crimson squad. They're going to mark him just shy of the line to gain. So 56 seconds left in the spring game. I mean, the last football we'll see here until September 1st for the season opener between the Crimson Storm and the Weevils of Arkansas and Monticello. Again, our thanks to Coach West, Hayda, Coach Sindel, Coach Brown, being up here with us and sharing some insights on just this team as a whole, the program, and what we can look forward to in 2022. And then there's always a lot of excitement when you see young guys performing, you see young guys stepping up, and it always. You know, brings you that hope. Obviously SNU yet to put up a winning record in the D2 era, but there's always, you're always looking for reasons to believe and hope, and you see the potential with these young guys and how they have performed and stepped up in big moments and in just the everyday as well. And there's plenty of reason for optimism with this Crimson Storm squad, with the way we've seen some of these young guys perform both last year and even tonight, and how the coaches have talked about them.
Yeah, something I'm taking out of this is that no one's backing down. They're not giving up just because they're down a little bit. Everybody's still trying to get better and get out there and win. Let's see.
See if we're doing anything special here. Look like they called a penalty on the Crimson squad. So 1st and goal for the white squad inside 10-yard line with the clock moving 43 seconds and counting. Tight formation here, and Evans is just going to take a knee and run it out. We'll call it a night.
I'm kind of surprised by that call. I thought they'd want to get in a couple extra practice snaps, but I guess Coach saw enough of the spring game and said, let's go home.
So the white squad comes out victorious tonight, 20-7, and some good ribbing going on out there from both guys. But overall, a great night here for the Crimson Storm. Good to see just where the program's at, and good to see these guys go at it a little bit on the football field. So we will wrap things up. Sam, thanks for joining me tonight. This was fun. And look forward to seeing what the Crimson Storm put out on the field in 2022.
Hey, it was my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
That's going to do it for us. Big weekend for SNU Athletics coming up here in the next few days. Baseball Friday and Saturday against Arkansas Monticello over at Phelan Field. Be sure to come on over for that series. If not, to keep it right here on the SNU Athletics YouTube channel, we'll have the full broadcast for you for the weekend. And so until September 1st, that's going to do it for us from SNU Football Stadium. For Sam Perkins, I'm Luke McConnell saying good night from Bethany.